Coming up, Blue Origin going to the moon.
SpaceX is going beyond the moon. And I'm over the moon with Tory Bruno in today's interview.
Oh, these moon jokes are so cheesy. All that and more coming up on this episode of TMRO.
Good morning. How's everything up in the sky?
Hello and welcome to Orbit 10, Episode 9. I am Carrie Ann, and of course with me is Benjamin and everyday astronaut Tim and another Tim Dutta back there and all other sorts of fun, interesting things happening. In any case, though, before we get started, I do want to give a huge shout out to our Escape Velocity patrons. These are the people who've donated given us $10 or more for this particular segment, this particular episode. And if you would like to get your name in the show, always feel free to head over to patreon.com/TMRO. I'm speaking very quickly because we have so many huge, huge, amazing, wonderful things to talk about.
This was a great week for space nerds.
This week was crazy.
Yeah. This is a big one.
The cosmos was like, you care about the moon again.
Right. Oh, my goodness. Okay, but first of all, we need to start off with the launches. We have a couple of things, which Rocket Road Trip, we said we would talk about in After Dark if you missed that, but with our pre-show thing going on. But Ben, tell us a little bit about our Atlas launch.
Well, first off, we have a NROL-79 launch. That's National Reconnaissance Office. This is on an Atlas V rocket. Check it out.
3, 2, we have ignition of the RD-180 main engine. 1, liftoff of the United Launch Alliance Atlas V rocket carrying the NROL-79 mission for the National Reconnaissance Office.
That launched March 1st at 1749 Coordinated Universal Time out of Vandenberg. And that is in the 401 configuration, meaning 4-meter fairing, no solid strap to the side, and one upper stage engine. That was the 70th Atlas V launch. And it was carrying, as they mentioned, NROL-79, which is a Naval Ocean Surveillance System, or NOS. It's a spy satellite for the NRO. And that's about all the more information you're going to get on one of the U.S. spy satellites.
But, I mean, look at that. Look at, particularly for a Vandenberg launch, that is, like, the clearest launch I've seen out of there.
To be fair, Vandenberg
Hashtag
launches...
maybe ever.
Yeah, Vandenberg launches are 50-50. They'll either be beautiful and clear, and you get the ocean in the background and those gorgeous mountains and hills, or covered in fog. You're never entirely sure which one you're going to get out of Andy. But yeah, absolutely gorgeous launch. Next up, a surprise launch from China. This is the KT-2 launch. This happened March 2nd at 2353. As per usual, not a lot of footage from China, but we'll give you what we got. There you go. This is a brand new rocket. It's a new solid rocket for China. As I mentioned, it's known as the KT-2. It's a small sat launcher, adding to their, at this point, ginormous fleet of small sat launchers. and of course, the payload was a small sat known as TK-1. And it will be, quote, used for remote sensing, telecommunications, and experiments in mini satellite based technologies. So there you go. Those were the two launches from this last week.
That is so great.
Yeah.
And
I feel like they're just, instead of, you know how a lot of organizations just build a rocket and then they like standardize on it, they build a bunch of them. I feel like China is just like building a new rocket for every launch. They're just like, oh, let's start over from scratch and build a new rocket. They have so many different rockets at this point.
You need to iterate. You need to go, that one wasn't quite right. I need to fix this. It's just a little bit.
They're just throwing rockets at the wall and seeing what sticks. Like, that one was cool. Let's try this one, though.
I have no qualms with that. As far as I'm concerned, if you can do it, do it. Like,
yeah. They're doing it. They're doing it.
Full-blown Kerbal. They are Kerbal.
Full-blown Kerbal.
Yes, that's
Hashtag full-blown Kerbal. That's what we need. Yep.
That's totally what we need. Oh, my goodness. Okay, so Tim, start us off with some news that I don't think anybody was really expecting.
No. Okay. For those of you that don't know, on Sunday, Elon Musk, the CEO of SpaceX, tweeted randomly, like in the middle of the afternoon, something like, announcement tomorrow at 1 p.m. And that's not something he typically does for SpaceX. And so everyone kind of was sitting there going, oh, you know, speculating what it will be, what it will be. A lot of people were thinking spacesuits or, you know, something about Mars or something. And out of the blue, he announces that they have two people who have paid a significant down payment to fly around the moon at the end of 2018. Absolutely mind blowing. I don't think anyone saw this coming. so what they ended up doing, so they'll be taking their Crew Dragon capsule, which should be testing this year, at the end of this year, should be doing a crewless, just a demo mission, and then they will be putting it on top of their Falcon Heavy, which should be flying here sometime hopefully this year. It needs to have a few flights on it, I think, before we consider putting humans on board. And that Falcon Heavy will be able to push a Crew Dragon capsule out to a nice little free return trajectory around the moon and back, and it's going to be absolutely incredible. So yeah, I mean, that's really about all the details we have at this point. But some of the fun things would be, if that does fly at the end of 2018, it could coincide with the 50th anniversary of Apollo 8, which Apollo 8 was a CisLunar flight around the moon. So that'd be really cool.
Yeah.
And worst goes to worst, if it goes until the next summer, it could coincide with the Apollo 11 50th anniversary as well. So hopefully, you know, by between those two, I'm really hoping that, you know, one of them ends up happening.
Yeah.
I want so bad. I think that's going to
be really
so
cool.
So.
Also, just really quickly, for those of us who weren't alive at the time, note the significance of how closely Apollo 8 and Apollo 11 were, right?
Well, it wasn't like they were back to back.
No, but I mean, like within 6 months, we did some like really amazing, major crazy pants things. Crazy pants.
Seven months.
Yeah. That's huge.
We had Apollo 8, Apollo 9, Apollo 10, and Apollo 11 within 7 months.
Yeah.
That's insane.
Well, we did the entire lunar program in like under a decade.
No, I know, but yeah. I'm just saying, but like, hey, we barely got humans up. Hey, we threw them around the moon. Hey, we got them on the moon. Like,
we threw them around the moon. No, and actually, one big difference is, remember, Apollo 8 did enter lunar orbit.
Yeah.
So it actually went into a lunar orbit, and I don't believe Gray Dragon is doing that. I don't know what that's what we're calling it.
Gray Dragon is doing a free return trajectory, which means it doesn't have enough delta V, most likely, to put itself into lunar orbit, and then, again, break lunar orbit in order to make it back to Earth. So it's just doing a clean little figure eight pattern, which will still be really cool.
Yeah.
And rumor has it, it'll be the furthest away actually from Earth that people will have ever been. So they're going to probably break Apollo 13's record, which I think was, I don't quite remember, something like 240 or 50,000 miles. And it sounds like they're going to go ways beyond that even, which will be really, really cool.
Nice. Not that that wasn't a huge announcement. But Blue Origin.
Jeff Bezos was like, yeah, cool, us too.
A lot of stuff. This isn't really.
I love this picture of Jeff Bezos too.
Yes.
It's all like, I actually kind of want that
it's
Blue Origin.
Super BA.
I want the blue coat, is what I want. They've been circulating a 7-page white paper to NASA leadership and the President Trump transition team talking about developing a lunar spacecraft and lander. They are planning a blue moon lunar lander at the Shackleton Crater on the moon's south pole. That specific spot is important because there is water, ideally frozen, because it's kind of like on the cusp of sunlight and not sunlight.
Darkness?
I was going to say moonlight, but that doesn't apply there.
We'll just say moonlight. It sounds way better that way.
sun and darkness. And so they'll have frozen water, but they'll be close enough where they can use the solar power for the like photovoltaics and sun and power generation.
I love
it. They're going to first off deliver gear for experiments, cargoes, and HABs, hopefully by the mid-2020. Now, what I didn't get clarification on is that like June 2020, or do they mean 2025? I assume.
Oh, like the mid-2020s?
Uh-huh. It said mid-2020.
Decade or year.
Exactly. So I'm going to go with mid-2020 because it's more ambitious and I want us to go there faster.
It sounds way cooler.
I have no idea. So, so one of the two. I mean, still 2025 or 2020, that's still pretty close. Here's a neat thing.
It's happening.
They're developing the technology for these landers now. So they're saying the new Shepard vehicle that they've got could be used as the kind of the landing technology for landing on the moon. So they're kind of all the stuff they're testing here on Earth, they can then reuse on the moon.
Sure.
And then Jeff Bezos did have a couple of quotes out of this. The first one being, a permanently inhabited lunar settlement is a difficult and worthy objective. I sense a lot of people are excited about this. He also said, Blue Moon is all about cost-effective delivery of mass to the surface of the moon. Any credible first lunar settlement will require that capability. And one could argue, as we've had, you know, we've had Dave Masson on the show multiple times saying, you know, moon first before Mars, you can use the moon as a launching post for Mars. So he could be setting up some pretty cool stuff for going to Mars in the future.
Yeah. Yeah. Really cool.
Very much so. Yeah, something not quite as cool as that. Do you want me to talk about what I was going to talk about next?
Yes, please. Jeez.
Oh, after talking about two awesome moon missions, it's time to talk about safety.
Yes.
Boring.
It is boring, but
everyone's favorite topic.
Like, nobody wants anybody to get hurt in all of these things. Like, we want is to succeed. So safety is part of that.
So part of the safety thing is, traditionally, there's literally been a guy kind of sitting there with his hand over a button. Hopefully the button has like a cover on it or something, but he's sitting there waiting and watching the trajectory of each rocket launch and making sure that, you know, if that rocket goes off course and looks like it's going to, you know, do anything that could remotely come into contact with property or humans, they go boom and it goes boomy, right? And that's a termination system, a flight termination system. Well, and recently, the Air Force has been giving out, they basically developed an autonomous flight safety system, or AFSS. And what this does is it's actually been flying on the backup system as a secondary system to a lot of rockets lately. But for the first time on SpaceX's CRS-10, it was the primary system. And what this is a 100% automated version of that flight termination system. So if it has a lot of redundant parts inside it, different GPS trackers and inertial movement units or things that can sense which direction it's going. And if it senses that something is wrong and it's outside of its parameter, it will blow itself up. And that's actually a really good, I know that sounds, it, to me that sounds like a thing that could fail really, but this is to prevent, it's basically an abundance of caution. And another thing you might say is, you know, why are they worrying about this right now? Well, it's really hard to track as spacecraft get more and more advanced and as they get more and more complicated, such as the Falcon Heavy. It will have three cores flying and a second stage flying. And if you have to track all four of those moving parts through the sky, you better have some autonomous system that's paying attention, a lot closer attention than a human could, you know.
At least it's faster. You make those calculations that much faster. Yeah.
So actually, yeah. adding to that, I actually know that as AFTS, so Autonomous Flight Termination System. So I don't know if there are two different acronyms for the same thing, or because the traditional termination system is known as FTS, it's Flight Termination
FTS.
System. So right. I don't know if they just switched the acronym, if they're both, or what the deal is. But
you may hear
it referred to as AFTS as well. One other thing, and one of the reasons this is important, is specifically looking at the East Coast launch sites, we've got a lot of different people trying to launch out of there. We've got ULA with the Atlas Delta and soon Vulcan. We've got SpaceX with their Falcon rockets. Then we've got Blue Origin going to start launching out of there. Right. I forgot which slick they have. Slick 30. Then we've got, I don't remember if I mentioned, Space Launch System going to start launching out of there. And then there was another small sat launcher that just announced launching out of there.
Yes.
If the range needed to track and perform flight termination on every single one of those launchers, we would have contention in the turnaround time necessary to launch from, you know, provider A to provider B, provider C. So moving to AFTS allows the range to actually support a greater number of launches, which would be very cool.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Very cool.
Yeah.
All right, Ben.
Cool. Born.
Why don't we, there was some more news.
More news. We'll end with this one. Virgin Galactic is breaking up. It sounds bad.
It does.
It's not bad. It's actually pretty cool.
It's a good thing.
It's a good thing. They're splitting the company. Right now there's the spaceship company and Virgin Galactic. The spaceship company makes the spaceships. Virgin Galactic will then fly and operate said spaceships. Well, now there are going to be two different operating companies. One is Virgin Galactic, and the second is going to be Virgin Orbit. Virgin Orbit is basically taking their Launcher One program and moving it into its own company. So there you see, that's actually Cosmic Girl. That is a Boeing 747 that has been repainted. It's from Virgin Atlantic. They repainted it with the Virgin Galactic, soon-to-be Virgin Orbit logo. And off of that is what they will drop Launcher One from. Now, George Whitesides, who is currently the CEO of Virgin Galactic, will remain CEO of both companies. So he's CEO of Virgin Galactic and Virgin Orbit. And then Dan Hart, who is a veteran Boeing executive, will become Virgin Orbit's president. And then you can see the 747
cool.
Cosmic Girl dropping Launcher One.
That's awesome.
The target price of one of those launches, by the way, is below $10 million per flight, and it's going to be able to loft 200 kilograms, which is about 440 pounds to low Earth orbit. And they're hoping to debut fly this in the end of this year, 2017.
Nice.
So that'll be really cool. Set the timers to December 31st.
Aww, that's just
come on,
mean.
That's how the space industry goes.
The whole industry feels like sometimes for sure.
Yeah, for sure.
Oh my goodness.
That's
okay.
Very cool.
That was great, you guys. We had some really great news. That was awesome. We covered some really big things, really exciting things. And yeah, so I feel good about this. You?
Absolutely.
Yeah?
Yeah.
All right. So
yeah.
we're gonna go ahead and head into break. And when we come back, our very own Jared Head has a great interview coming up with the one and only Tory Bruno. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Look into her face, determination in her eyes. She won't give up or quit or fumble little fashion lies. Filled with awesome expectation, this girl's a fascination.
Hello, folks, and welcome back to Tomorrow. Now, before we get started with our interview with Tory Bruno, the CEO of United Launch Alliance, we first want to thank our patrons of Tomorrow, of the Escape Velocity variety. These folks are giving us $10 or more per episode. And in addition to that, we also want to thank our Orbital variety folks. These folks are giving us $5 or more per episode. And if you would like to help crowdfund the shows of tomorrow, head on over to patreon.com/TMRO. Well, this is it, everybody. We've been waiting very long time to bring you on, Mr. Bruno, the CEO of United Launch Alliance. Just a little bit of background about yourself. You served as the vice president and general manager of the Lockheed Martin Strategic and Missile Defense Systems. You joined ULA on August 12th, 2014, and you've been there for just about 3 years. Well, you've been at Lockheed Martin for over 30 years, since 1984. You have a bachelor's degree in mechanical engineering from the California Polytechnic State University, San Luis Obispo. And you've also written two books, very interestingly, about the Knights Templar as organization for management, which is pretty interesting. So, Tory, welcome to Tomorrow, and welcome to our observation deck.
Well, thank you. I'm thrilled to be here. And I got to say, I love that news report. I'm all jazzed and excited now.
Yeah, it's always exciting when we've got so much to talk about. And that's been one of the great things over the past couple of years, is that it seems like every week we get more and more to talk about. So speaking of talking about, let's talk a little bit about you to go ahead and get the interview started off. You're the CEO of United Launch Alliance, one of the biggest aerospace companies here in the United States and in the world. And what is your day-to-day like at United Launch Alliance?
Oh, a typical day at ULA? Sure. But I'm going to tell you, but before I do that, I think we have to take a moment and acknowledge your hair.
Oh, yes. That, if you'd like
that
to.
That is awesome.
Yes, it's pretty.
What do you think? Could I sport that? Would it work for me?
I think you could. And what's one of the cool things is that you'll notice it's an aerodynamic feature, so it ends up stabilizing you as you walk. So
yeah, you know, turbulent flow.
Yeah, very good.
Well, yeah. So typical day for me at ULA. So when I'm here, when I'm in Colorado, where headquarters is, because I do travel a lot. It starts early, you know, I'll wake up at, you know, anywhere between 3 and 4 a.m. The alarm clock never goes off, you know, because it's, you know, there's space happening and you just sort of wake up and you want to get going. And I'll come into the office. I usually get there before a lot of other folks, you know, and I'll catch up on some paperwork and stuff. But then we start the day with first looking at the manifest, what launches are coming up, what is the team working on, do they have everything they need to be able to solve whatever problem might be on the pad or any issue that they're trying to work. And then we'll typically go off and we'll work on our strategy. You know, we always have that North Star really in focus. Where are we trying to go to really change the future of space, transform our company, make things like our revolutionary ACES upper stage happen? That gets talked about every single day. Then we'll, you know, we'll work with our people. We'll have, you know, maybe a skip level meeting. I should probably explain what that is.
Sure.
So about once a week, certainly maybe 2-3 times a month at a minimum, I like to bring folks in to see me who don't work directly for me. And so it might be a group of new hires. It could be a group of, you know, frontline managers, you know, people who are in organization but would not normally see me or work directly for me. And we close the door, we get about a dozen of them.
I sit back and I say, okay, it's a skip level meeting. You have to do all the work. What do you guys want to talk about? You can ask me anything. You can tell me anything you think I should be the CEO. And then they lead the conversation.
Interesting. Yeah. Sounds like a pretty pretty good organization that you've got going. So speaking of that, what's your philosophy in running an aerospace company? Because there's many different approaches that you can take. So what's your philosophy on it?
Well, sure. You know, some people think that an aerospace company is all about technology. And there's certainly truth to that. The technological things that we do are so far above and beyond what any other industry requires. But the secret is, it's not actually about the technology. It's about the people. A company like ours, any true aerospace company, the people are the most precious asset. It is all about the people. It's about their knowledge, their dedication, and their commitment to the mission.
What do you feel is interesting about working with people in aerospace? What's the overarching theme that you see with people in aerospace?
Well, there's all kinds of interesting things. I mean, you know, first off, you get to work with some of the smartest people on the planet, and it's just, it's inspiring to be around them. Even, you know, your interns and your entry-level people, they bring such an energy and commitment. Everybody cares about the mission really deeply. And then, you know, I'll just share that in our industry, there is probably a higher, sort of coefficient of eccentricity than maybe in other businesses.
Yeah, just a little bit sometimes with that. I know I'm a recovering aerospace engineer, so it's definitely one of those things I'm very well familiar with in that. So sort of changing gears a little bit to talk a little bit more about the technical aspects of things. What can you tell us about your upcoming Vulcan launch system?
Vulcan's pretty exciting. So we're starting with the booster, which replaces the venerable RD-180 sort of Russian rocket engine with an American engine using the same very advanced thermodynamic cycle, but much more producible, you know, much lower cost. And that rocket, that booster, which is more powerful than what we have on Atlas today and more affordable, also supports the ASUS upper stage that will go on that rocket in the next step.
So is Vulcan still in its design phase, or is it moving towards production?
So both. So when you go through the life cycle of designing a rocket, there's these big milestones. You'll be familiar with them as an aerospace engineer, but the first major one is called the preliminary design review. That happened a year ago. We're coming up on a critical design review this year. And at that point, you've really nailed down your design and you're confident to release everything to manufacturing. However, some items take so long to build that they have been in development for a long time and they've already begun being produced. And a great example would be Blue Origin's BE-4 rocket engine that will replace the RD-180.
Now, what makes Vulcan a superior choice to your current launch vehicles? Is it just the power and the lifting capacity, or is there something else involved in it that makes it better than what you've currently got?
Sure. It's a combination of things. So it is a more powerful rocket. It's a rocket that is easier to produce and costs less to manufacture. It is also quicker to assemble at the launch site, integrate with a spacecraft, and put into space. As we've been designing it, we've brought sort of the latest techniques and philosophies around design, and we are using a process we call design for manufacturing and assembly. And so we'll have our engineering teams, after they've built the basic architecture rocket, zero in these, we call them sprints, on a specific subsystem. They'll get it designed pretty well, they'll be happy with it, and they race down to the factory or to the launch site where we have made either additively manufactured or even just plywood. We'll get the techs, we'll get people who build and launch them, they'll work together, and sometimes they'll throw the whole design out and they'll come up with a new one that's very easy to put together, going to be very affordable, and then they'll move on to the next system. And so it's a whole philosophy around having a rocket that is more flexible, can launch very easily a very wide spectrum of spacecraft at a much lower cost, And of course, it's easier to put together. It's more reliable. You're less likely to make a mistake when you assemble it. It's just that whole universe.
Now, I know from working on my own projects that there's always challenges that come up and obstacles to overcome. So what are some of the challenges that you've had to come up with and face on your own while developing Vulcan?
Well, sure. You know, we're going to have a pretty large content of additively manufactured hardware. So we have had to figure out which parts are appropriate for that. Everything on the rocket isn't actually a good candidate for additive manufacturing. So you have to pick the right ones. The next thing that's a challenge just about that one particular, you know, element is that additively manufactured parts are so new, there are not big databases of material properties and strengths and erosion rates. So you really have to develop that as you go. If you use a conventional material, it's a completely different story. There's a handbook, you can pull it off the shelf, there's standards. You don't have that with AM. And then, of course, there's the engine itself. We're carrying these two engines along in parallel until we make our down selection. They use different propellants, and that has a fundamental impact on the design of the booster itself. So we're having to bring both designs along. One is much farther along than the other, but keeping the ability to switch back if we have to, and then also maintaining all the hooks and connections to be able to put that ACES upper stage on top of the booster.
Yeah, and to talk a little bit about that, reusability is kind of the big buzzword in spaceflight right now. It's, if you want to get a lot of people talking about you, you just say the word reusability, and that's the key way to do it.
Okay, reusability.
Yes. So how's Vulcan going to be incorporating reusability?
Yeah, so there's two things. There's a reusability element to the booster itself, which is much along the same kind of lines as what other people are trying to accomplish in terms of economics. You know, can we make this simply less expensive to launch a rocket? And so we've taken a little bit different track than some of the other folks. We really kind of put, you know, those systems engineering lenses on and said, okay, you know, you could fly back the whole booster. There's, you know, good reasons to do that. And once you get the hang of it, it's going to save you money. But let's take another broader look at it. And when we did, we said, well, it turns out that 2/3 of the price of that thing is literally one part. It's the rocket engine. And so our approach to reusability on the booster is to just capture the engine itself, sever it from the booster, let it re-enter behind an inflatable heat shield that we're developing together with NASA. They're producing it for the next Mars mission. Pop some parachutes, scoop it up with an aircraft, and take it home just like the old Corona space satellite. And the advantages of that approach that we like are the fact that you don't have to save any propellant to fly home with. So you get to do it every single time. No spacecraft would be so heavy that you weren't able to reuse it. And then you don't have to capture the parts of the booster that are inexpensive and yet difficult to refurbish and recover. But that's kind of mundane. I mean, as cool as that is, the part that's really exciting is the upper stage. That's a revolution. ACES is going to change everything about how we go to space and what we're able to do there, because it will be a fully reusable, refuelable in space stage that will become the pickup truck of space. We will stop deorbiting our upper stage. We'll leave it there every time we take a primary mission up, gas it up, and begin building a fleet, a transportation system that will allow us to really develop lunar space.
So ESL Burndy, one of our chat room members, has a really good question, which is that Vulcan is going to be, he asked that Vulcan is going to fly with a Centaur upper stage on the first flight. So when can we expect ACES to fly?
So ACES will fly about 2023. Could fly faster. In fact, if we did not need to replace the Russian rocket, we'd probably be doing ACES first. But since most of the money is coming privately, you know, we're doing them kind of in series. First, the booster, which will fly with Vulcan Centaur, and then we'll do ACES. We'll retire Centaur, and Centaur will never fly again.
So what are some of the difficulties that you're having to deal with ASUS? Because this is something that nobody has, truly nobody really has ever done before, which is refueling in space. So what are some of the things that you have to deal with in that?
Sure. I'd put them in two buckets. There's technology, and then there's culture and acceptance, because it's so radically different in terms of what can be done. So let me start with the technology piece. You know, the fundamental idea behind ASUS that allows it to do what it's going to do, which is to have a tremendously long lifespan in space, is that we capture our propellants. See, our upper stage is a cryogenic upper stage, unlike many others, which means that the propellants are very, very, very cold, so cold that even in the freezing temperatures of space, they're continually boiling off. And that is what limits the life of the stage. Well, on ASUS, the idea is to capture those propellants, don't waste them to space, bring them back down, put them inside a system that can use those propellants for power. So today, you know, Centaur is a conventional stage. There's a hydrazine system for attitude control. There's a big helium farm with bottles that provide pressure inside the propellant tanks to push the propellants out through the engine. And there's long-duration batteries. Well, if we can capture that boil-off propellant and make use of its energy, all that stuff goes away. We actually are developing an internal combustion engine with Roush, the race car company, that will burn hydrogen and oxygen as propellants and run a piston engine. And then that piston engine runs a heat exchanger compressor to push the propellants out through the engine so the helium goes away. We're developing a hydrogen thruster that'll replace the whole hydrazine propulsion system. And then since it's an engine, well, just hook up an alternator for power and you don't have any batteries anymore, any long duration batteries.
Now, to go back into our chat room, Jason519 has a question that I think will kind of lead into my questions about CisLunar 1000, which is that his question is, these days we usually have six people in orbit continually. What do you think that space-based workforce will be in 10 years?
Oh, it'll be several hundred. So this is the really exciting thing, Jared, to be alive right now when we are about to take our first bold steps for a permanent human presence beyond this planet. You know, the caller, the texter is exactly right. It's just a handful of people. They're astronauts. They're elite folks that have trained. They're really tourists, if you will, not in the commercial sense, but they're people that visit space and are going to come home. When we are able to put this transportation system in space, we're going to be able to do economic activities in space. We're going to put businesses in space, which means jobs. So people will go to space because their job is in space and they'll live there. This will become their new home. And all of that is going to happen over the next couple of decades.
So can you explain CisLunar 1000? Because it sounds like, from my reading of what CisLunar 1000 is, that you guys are going to be helping really enable this. So what is CisLunar 1000?
CisLunar 1000 is our vision for the first 1,000 people that live and work in space. And so it's a concept where there is a transportation system. It's got nodes in it. I'm going to go build the railway to space. And then we have lots of friends and partners and colleagues that are entrepreneurs for space businesses that are going to get them use that transportation system to go to space to generate, you know, wealth and jobs and really create that infrastructure that will become sort of the new frontier where people go there because they can have a better life there.
But why CisLunar space? How is it economically important?
Well, it turns out that there are just tremendous resources in CisLunar space. And all of the things that we think about here on Earth that are rare and therefore valuable, you know, precious metals and rare materials and things like that, they're really only rare here on Earth because of their density. Over the millennia, they have sunk to the sort of the inner part of our planet where they're very difficult to get at and therefore very expensive. All of those materials reside in abundance on asteroids and on the moon. And because of lesser intensity of the gravity, they're basically just laying there. It's like the California gold rush where gold was laying in streams waiting to be picked up. It's like that there. There's over 1,500 near-Earth objects, asteroids, if you will, between here and the moon that have such an abundance of wealth and materials, it defies human imagination. And it turns out that, you know, two-thirds of the energy to get anywhere in the solar system is just climbing out of the Earth's well into Leo. And once you're up there, where ASUS will be building up this fleet of space trucks, it is much, much more practical to then get around between Earth and the moon and the near-Earth objects to take advantage of that tremendous, you know, body of of natural resources.
So Explorer, one of our chat room members, has a question. Do you see us mining the asteroids in 10 to 20 years? So I would imagine CisLunar 1000 would definitely enable you to do that.
Absolutely. I see us prospecting the asteroids within the next 5 to 10 and mining them easily within the next 10 to 20.
So another question from our chat room from Destructor 1701 is asking, is CisLunar 1000 independent of government, or does it require some government help for you to actually do this?
Well, government absolutely plays a role. You know, fundamentally, it is a private commercial activity, but government plays a key role in terms of helping to establish the environment that people will operate under. The exploration that the government has already done, that NASA has done, allows us the technologies and the understanding now commercially to go exploit this. And then there's a whole regime of, you know, legal and property rights and regulation that will need to be in place. If we're going to have a company, you know, gather investors and hire people and spend money to go out and prospect an asteroid and find, you know, just the right, you know, richest place to go mine it and bring it back and take it back to Earth, they need to be able to own that resource. They need to be able to sell it, and they need to be able to protect their mining claim. You can't have somebody else just sit back and watch until they find the richest deposits and then zoom in and try and take them at the same time. So government absolutely plays a role. There'll also be places where the government can be sort of a key anchor customer. You know, one of the activities that will happen very early will be commercial habitats in near-Earth orbit doing research in microgravity manufacturing. And so there will be opportunities for our government here in the U.S., but also other governments who would like to have the ability to expand their research footprint. That's an opportunity that will help that business get going and then attract its commercial customers.
So I'm going to take a question from our chat room from Andrew Shire and kind of modify it a little bit. He's asking about if CisLunar 1000 is mining and transportation focused, but I'm also going to add on about expanding humanity's reach to the solar system. Do you see CisLunar 1000 as something to be local, or do you see it as something to really expand out into the solar system with?
Oh, I think it's the launch pad that expands us out into the solar system. Remember what I said a few minutes ago, it takes so much energy just to get off the surface of the Earth. If you're really going to run out to Mars and back and other places in the solar system, you want to be doing a lot of that activity starting from a node that is in CisLunar space. And so we're looking to see materials that are gathered in CisLunar space and manufactured there to create the infrastructure that'll create that port, you know, out to the rest of the solar system. I mean, I sort of think of it this way, you know, if you live in the Alps, but you want to have, you know, a shipping trade in the Mediterranean, you might want a port down on, you know, in Italy on the coast someplace.
Yeah, good place to do it at. So is CisLunar 1000 a paper plan to get 1,000 humans living and working in space? Or is this an actual reality? And if it is something that's being pursued, how soon can we see something like CisLunar 1000?
Well, I think it absolutely is a reality. We're working on the technologies that will enable it right now. You know, I talked about some of the key of ASUS, which is that fundamental enabler. We're building hardware, we're testing it, we're demonstrating the fuel transfer part of that right now at the Marshall Space Flight Center with our partners at NASA. All that is happening. But it's also starting to become a movement. building a community of CisLunar entrepreneurs about a year or two ago. And we just had a really exciting event at our headquarters in Denver about 2 weeks ago. We called this the CisLunar Marketplace Workshop, and we invited about 60 companies, 60 of these space entrepreneurs, people who want to manufacture in space, who want to mine space, all these different activities. We brought them together at our facility, and we organized a workshop where they could sort of work on their business plans. They could identify what types of services and supply chains they might need, what type of infrastructure they might need. And then through the day, as they built that, they interacted with each other so that people suddenly discovered, well, you know, I need this type of support. And somebody else would say, well, that's my business. That's what I want to do in space. So we need to get together and jointly build our business plan. And we're going to continue that to broaden that community, connect them to the investor sort of community. And now we're even involved with the AIAA. So AIA has jumped on this and said, we want to sponsor panels and conferences to help develop the plans, the architectures, the technologies, and the standards that all of these businesses will need.
Now, I kind of want to jump back to ACES real quick, because we do have a question about it from our chat room from Chris DM. He's asking how additional fuel is going to be delivered to the ACES stages.
Sure. So it's a journey. First, we start by bringing fuel up from the surface of the Earth. So every rocket typically has some excess capacity. Once in a while, you lift a satellite that is just so heavy, you can't get one more kilogram on there. But normally, the rocket is the rocket, and you have big satellites and you have small ones. And so we will take rockets that have a lot of excess capability, and we'll bring extra fuel. And then we'll use that fuel initially to refuel the ACES stages that have gone up and stayed in space. Over time, we will move to mining water from the moon and from the asteroids to produce rocket fuel. See, I think that is really the great discovery of our time that has sort of gone largely unheralded, that water is everywhere. It's everywhere we look. At the opening of the show, people were talking about Jeff's plan to go to the Shackleton crater, where there are perpetual shadows and therefore moon, lunar ice, frozen water. There's that elsewhere on the moon. There's that on the asteroids. There's water on Mars, and of course the poles of the moon have over 20 billion metric tons of water. And so that's where the propellant will come from. Over time, we'll shift away from bringing it out of Earth's gravity well and start picking it up there, where it's much, much less expensive, and we could actually economically afford to mine it, manufacture it into propellant, and then sell it. That'll be one of the first businesses, I think, gas stations in space.
So from our chat room, Caster364 is actually asking a very interesting question, which is, can you see water as a currency? Sort of like in sci-fi's The Expanse. Do you see it sort of acting as like a currency in space?
Well, sort of. I see it really as a fundamental resource that will underpin the CisLunar economy. If you think about Earth, Earth is really foundational relative to fossil fuels. Fossil fuels underpin every economic activity we have on our planet here. If you think about it, there isn't anything that you've purchased that didn't involve gasoline or petroleum somewhere. If you went to the store to pick it up, you drove there in your car. It got delivered on a truck. It came from China on a ship. I mean, it's all really foundational to petroleum, to energy, whatever the source of energy is. And on Earth today, that happens to be petroleum. In CisLunar space, that foundation will be water. This will be a water-based economy. And so, ice cubes will not literally be money. The economy itself will be residing on that foundation of water.
And to talk a little bit about CisLunar space with one of our good friends of the show, Masten Space Systems, can you tell us a little bit about the Zeus project that you guys are working on with them?
Yeah, Masten's one of our very early CisLunar marketplace partners, and we have been working with them to help create a lunar lander that would be affordable to sort of move things back and forth, because one of the transportation nodes in this future will be the Earth-Moon Lagrange point one, which is that location in space between Earth and the Moon where the gravitational forces roughly balance, so it's sort of easy to hang out there. That'll be a depot. That'll be a train station in space. And so you're going to need shuttles to go back and forth to do economic activities on the Moon and then ferry materials and people back up to EML-1 to get on the freight train, you know, out to Mars or back to Earth, collect up, you know, large quantities of manufactured goods to move to other places. And so Masten has been a partner we've worked with for a long time. We actually provided them a while back with a scrapped Centaur upper stage so that they could experiment with it. And we are helping them develop that capability. Zeus is our version of a lander that could be really sort of attached to an ASIS upper stage. We might do that together with them or other people or even by ourselves. But it would allow us to come down and land on the Moon. Our concept is horizontally. A lot of lunar landers want to land vertically, which is fine, but it makes the logistics of getting material and people in and out of the rocket a little bit more difficult than if it were closer to the surface.
Now, what else should we look for in ULA's future? Because you're a very rapidly evolving company now. What are some of the upcoming things that we should pay attention to?
Sure. Well, what's coming next, of course, will be offering Vulcan into the marketplace. So, you know, we did a couple of, I think, exciting things last year that weren't really about technology. They were more about how people will get their ride to space. So we released a program we called Rapid Launch. You know, today, if you want to go to space, I should say yesterday because we've changed it, you buy that ride to space 3 years in advance of going there. Never shorter than 2 years, because that's how long it takes to build a rocket, and rockets are typically, you know, built made to order, and there is always a certain amount of customization on the rocket for your individual spacecraft. Well, we thought, golly, that makes it really hard on the people who want to go to space. They're buying their ride before their spacecraft is even done being built or designed in some cases. They're tying up a lot of money up front to do that. It's kind of a barrier. There's got to be a way to make this easier. So we figured out how to take all the customization work and move it all the way to the very end of the manufacturing process. Then we collapsed all the spans. It now takes half as long to build a rocket at ULA as it did just a couple of years ago. It only takes about a third as much time once that rocket gets out to the pad to be assembled, mated to the spacecraft, and literally go to space. We have done that part in as short as 17 days.
Wow.
And with the tempo we can maintain, you know, we can fly within a week. We can launch two rockets within a week. So we call that rapid launch, and it means that you can buy your ride to space as close to as 3 months from your launch date. And so that's been kind of a, you know, sort of an earthquake in the space launch industry. The other thing we did was the rocket builder web-based tool. It's complicated to figure out what rocket you want to fly on and how much it's going to cost and what where the sort of the breakpoints are in terms of how much mass you put on your spacecraft. If you add one more kilogram, oops, now you have to add an SRB, and you know, there went a bunch of millions of dollars. Or if you added, you know, 3 more centimeters to the diameter of the stowed condition, you had to hop to a more expensive payload ferry. Now people can figure all that out for themselves in real time in just a few minutes, even before they call us to decide, you know, that they want to talk to us about a rocket. So we've done those two things. We'll be Vulcan. Pretty soon Vulcan will be mature enough that we're going to offer it to the marketplace. It will appear in Rocket Builder. It will continue to support Rapid Launch. You'll be able to buy that ride 3 months out, or, you know, obviously 2 years, but as close as 3 months. And I think that's going to be pretty exciting. And I've got a couple of things that are going to be in Vulcan that we haven't talked about that are going to be pretty exciting
but I'm not going to tell you yet.
Yeah, just dangle the little carrot and then make sure not to get it. So, yeah, well, we look forward to hearing about those in the future. So just a few more questions before we get into our Ben standard questions with that there. Is there any... Kevin or Kay McCoy is asking that he's very interested to hear about how you use social media because you are very accessible on social media. Is there any memorable interactions, or have you hired any aerospace engineers from that, or what's it sort of like being very accessible on social media while still maintaining being a CEO at a major aerospace company?
Well, I'll say yes and yes. We absolutely have hired people as a result of that. Folks have reached out to me and told me about their passion in space, and I've encouraged them to apply or send a resume, and it turns out that's a great fit, and there are people working at ULA today because of that interaction. I have had some very interesting interactions on social media. I'll start by saying it is actually me. There's no one else doing it for me, and there's nobody who sort of reviews and approves my tweets and responses before they go out. I understand that's actually pretty rare. A lot of the senior industry executives that you might, you know, think you're hearing from or interacting with on social media, you're really not. Not at least not directly. But when you get me, it's all me. It's real time. And, you know, I sort of have a professional mission as a CEO to make space more accessible, but I also have a personal goal to make the industry that causes all that to happen and become possible to also be more accessible. So that's also and largely why I do this and why I spend so much time on it. You know, I've had people who sort of start out with preconceived notions about our company, and they might be a little bit hostile, and I think that is the thing that frightens a lot of executives away from wanting to engage. But as long as people are, you know, they're not swearing at me or sort of, you know, crazy over the top, I'll talk with anybody. And more often than not, you know, as I answer their questions and they, you know, they get some facts and their enthusiasm and their passion for space sort of takes over, and it ends up being a really positive interaction. I've had a couple of folks who I would say like me just a little bit too much, and so those were some interesting interactions, but we won't say anything more about those, I think.
All right, also from our chat room, Vogan wants to know, how easy is it to dust your rocket collection that you've got behind you?
Oh, that takes a while. you're seeing the tip of the iceberg. These are my favorite ULA rockets, but over my career, I've done over 36 different rockets. I've done hypersonic gliders, I've done lasers, I've done all kinds of things. And so that is a small fraction of the memorabilia that is here in my home as well as in my office at work.
And also from our chat room, Missy Hawk wants to know, do you play Kerbal Space Program?
I do. I love KSP.
Yeah, we always like it because it lets you do the things that you're sort of not allowed to do with rockets.
Yeah,
You can do horrible things to rockets with that game. And then in finality, basically from our entire chat room, with the dangling of the carrot with some surprises coming in from Vulcan, can you give us any hints about that, or do we just have to deal with not knowing for a little bit of time?
Oh, no more hints today.
All right, Tory. Now we're going to go over just some standard questions that we have. We asked these 5 questions to all of our guests. No right or wrong answers. Just tell us exactly how you feel about it. So the first question is, Moon or Mars first?
Moon first.
All right. Would you go to space?
Absolutely. But don't tell Mrs. Bruno.
When do you think humans will first land on Mars?
Oh, in the next, just in the next few years. NASA has a real focus on Mars exploration, and I see that being carried through.
When do you think humans will set foot on the moon again?
Sooner than that.
And our final question, and my favorite question out of all of these 5, is why space?
well, you know, this planet that we live on is so precious, and it is a finite resource. And yet, right there, you know, just beyond, just a few miles from where you and I are sitting right now, is a whole universe of possibilities. And space inspires us. It will be our human destiny to go there. And when we do, it will make everything here on Earth so much better.
Excellent. Well, Tory, I want to thank you so much for coming on the show today. It's been fantastic, and it's been a privilege to interview you here on Tomorrow.
Oh, it's my pleasure.
All right. And now what we're going to do, we're going to go ahead and head to break. And when we come back from break, your comments from last week's show. See you soon.
We've always looked to the stars. They guide us, give us comfort, help us find our way. We see ourselves out there. When we look up, it inspires us. And we long for something we don't yet know. We yearn to go there. So we venture forth.
We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other thing, not because they are easy, but because they are hard. Because that goal will serve to organize and measure the best of our energies and skills.
Tranquility Base here. The Eagle has landed. It's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
The exploration of space will go ahead, whether we join in it or not.
Many think we stopped exploring. But we know our journey didn't end. We've only just begun.
Orion is functioning perfectly at this point.
Come with us and explore tomorrow.
And welcome back to Tomorrow. Now, before we get started with the comments section, I did want to give a shout out to all of the patrons of Tomorrow who've helped to make this specific segment of this episode happen. These are people who've contributed $10 or more to this specific episode. We've also got our orbital subscribers. They're people who've contributed $5 or more. And our suborbital subscribers. These are people who've contributed $2.50 or more, and they're going to get access to After Dark and all the neat little goodies that come along with it. And we've got our ground support crew. These are people who've contributed $1 up to $2.49. To find out how you can help crowdfund the shows of tomorrow, head on over to patreon.com/TMRO. All right, let's get started with comments from last week's show, which was all about you.
No, it wasn't.
Well, it was about you. It was a lot about you. How's that?
It was too much about me. Let's never do that again.
All right, Capcom.
Okay, so first comment, thankfully not about me, comes off of YouTube. This one comes from Robert Beasley Bob, which is such a great name, I'm not going to lie. It says, ugh, I hate hearing that the RS-25s are going to be expendable. Damn shame.
Yeah, a little bit. I mean, those engines were high-performing, Hydrolox engines designed to be reused over and over and over again. Although, to be fair, the shuttle did kind of like take them apart and then like rebuild them each time. So reused more means refurbished, I think.
Go ahead.
I think it's important too to make sure everyone knows the RS-25 is the space shuttle main engine. And
right.
It has traditionally been reused every space shuttle mission. It would come back and there's three engines still attached.
Refurbished. I prefer the term refurbished over reused. I mean, you reuse a jet engine over and over and over again, right? You just kind of you kick it and go, okay, well, it still spins, looks good. But it seemed like the space shuttle main engines, someone who worked on the space shuttle program can maybe help clarify this, which is the shuttle would land, and then what would they do to the space shuttle main engines? Is the answer they would generally let it go for maybe 5 or 10 missions, or would they pull it out, inspect it, do all the stuff, and then put it back together? My understanding is they would pull it out and inspect it. But if they didn't, if they just kind of left it intact, you know, for 5 or 10 missions, you know, then you're kind of in between, you know, the tolerances of space stuff is just difficult. So
right?
You know, yeah, right. You know, they do inspect and pull out jet engines eventually too. It's just that they do it over very long periods of time.
Right.
So, yeah. All right, next up.
Next one also comes off of YouTube. This, I did not look at this particular name, so this will be fun. I get to pronounce this on air.
Here we go. First time. Go.
Astridislycus? Yeah, I should have practiced that one. I'm so sorry.
I think you were close.
Somebody is definitely going to tell me how to say that. Yeah, right? I'm so sorry, you guys. Says, though, this part I can read. Bye-bye, dear Soyuz U. Hello, 1.8 times more expensive Soyuz 2.
Well, I mean, yeah, that's not fair. You need to... Okay, so more expensive isn't necessarily good, but yeah, I mean, you do need to make progress forward, and, you know, a lot of times the new thing is going to cost more until you can figure out how to bring its cost down. Yeah. So, you know, just because it's more expensive now doesn't mean that it's going to be more expensive. Oh, gosh, Soyuz U ran for... 50 years? 30 years?
Well, sometimes you have to make the initial investment in order
a long time.
To, you know, for it to last longer.
Yeah.
Just
a really long time.
Yeah, exactly.
Really long
One
time.
Unit of a really long time. So
it's kind of okay.
It's not exactly fair. The new thing's probably going to be more expensive out of the gate.
We can measure. We'll start using Soyuz U as a measure of time.
Yes. That was three Soyuz U's.
Three Soyuz U's ago.
Fantastic.
Three Soyuz U time units. That's
it's
hard
like
to
saying
say.
4 score and 7 years ago, right?
All right. Next up.
This one comes off of YouTube as well. This one comes from Rocky Boulders. OMG.
Ha, that's something you would say.
Yeah, it is. All the rockets and technology don't mean a thing if you don't nail down the quote-unquote why. Carrie Ann brought it straight to the human soul and knocked this interview out of the park. This is what takes us to the stars.
Yeah, actually, in pre-show, I was talking to Tori.
Yep.
And saying something along the same lines, which is humans can't relate to rockets. They're just too big. They're too powerful. There's nothing in our life that we deal with on a daily basis that is anything like a rocket for most people, right? There might be a few. I realize we have rocket scientists and launch artists. Launch artists in the room who do deal with rockets on a daily basis, but you are the minority, most people just can't relate to it. So we ask everyone to tell stories that are human relatable, about other humans that connect humans to humans, because I think that's those are the stories we really want to hear, like some of those challenges and some of those exciting things. So
exactly, and what not about, to plug. Not to plug Everyday Astronaut too much, but that's kind of been my whole thing, is adding that human element, and especially with the sense of scale with this stuff. You know, when you see a human next to, you know, at the base of an Atlas V or at the base of a rocket, and you realize that they're just this little speck, and you're only seeing like 1% of the rocket. You're like, holy cow, you know, it's just...
You're launching a 20-story building into space going 22,000 kilometers an hour.
Yeah.
I mean, it's incredible.
It's hard to fathom, and that's why those human elements help bring it into that sense of scale.
I'll say I work in the industry, and I have the opportunity to see a lot of these vehicles, on their side. And even when you see them in person in a horizontal configuration, your brain still can't fathom how large they actually are. It isn't until you're standing quite literally right next to it in its vertical orientation, and you look up at it, and you go, oh, this thing's huge!
When you get dizzy looking at the top of something like that.
You can't quite see the top, you're like, whoa! I mean, it's just, it's really hard to relate. It's just really hard to relate. So yeah, I think the human side is super duper important. All right, spend too much time.
I really want to look down from the eye level with rocket and look down and see people down at the bottom. I feel like that'd be one of those views where another sense of scale.
Hope you're not afraid of heights.
I'm not. I'm excited to do that someday. Stay in there and look. I think that's going to be awesome.
Yeah. All right. Yeah. All right. Next up.
All right. Next one comes off of Facebook. This is from Charlie Fox. It says, great and unexpected interview. Yeah, I know, right? The unexpected part, not necessarily the great. Anyway, as a former Minnesotan, I'd like to hear how you two got into this and how much effort you put towards it. So much more effort on Ben's part than mine, really.
How do we get into it? That's a whole story in and of itself, right? I mean, that's
told that story. We had other podcasts. Yeah. You wanted to do this podcast.
Surprise,
I said
interview
no.
With Ben.
Told you were stupid. And then I said, you need me. There you go. That's
a short
version.
Yeah. All right. That's fair. It's pretty.
Right?
Episode 1 was terrible.
But yeah, you were also trying something completely new and different, though.
Yes,
that's
yes,
not
yes
fair.
It was.
Yeah, right. I mean, it was.
It's not
you,
it's, fair. That had nothing to do with me.
It's awful. Please don't watch it.
I think as anybody who produces any sort of anything, right, we all sort of feel that way about the first time of...
Your first thing, you're like, ugh.
Yeah, but that's... Yeah. You learn from that. Okay, anyway, last comment, right? Last comment, yes, comes off of YouTube. This one comes from Bobbert for him. Says,
multi-commenter.
Yes.
He's been on the show more than once.
Yeah. Carrion is the voice of reason amongst a band of space nerds.
Yep.
Space nerd too. Her willingness to pack it in if things get boring helps us keep the show genuinely interesting. Thank you. Like Penny from Big Bang Theory, Carrion is the outside observer who translates the high science and engineering into terms the average observer can engage with. Thank you. I wonder if the boys would have starved to death long ago without her.
Yes, I would have. That is without doubt. Also, hysterically, we took one of those Myers-Briggs
16 personalities
quizzes, and it tells you like who you're like. And
yeah, in case you have trouble relating or you don't really understand the four-letter acronym that they give you for the most part. And one of those personalities is, in fact, Penny from Big Bang Theory. So
nailed it!
I kind of laughed.
That's crazy.
All right, everyone, that is our show this week. Next week, we've got Anita Sengupta of the Jet Propulsion Laboratory, specifically NASA's Cold Lab, coming on. That's going to be an interesting and awesome conversation. So After Dark is up next. For those of you watching live, just stay tuned. It'll be happening. Otherwise, for those of you watching on demand, that'll be available to our patrons at the $2.50 or above level, or everyone else in about 4 weeks. Thank you so much for watching. Hope you enjoyed it. See you next week.